Let's say we have two sets, set A and set B. If we put this symbol in between those two sets, it's kind of like a curvy less than or equal sign. What that notation means is that A is a subset of B. And what it means for A to be a subset of B is that any element in A also has to be an element of B. Let me write out a few small sets to demonstrate. I just made up sets C, D, and E, and set D has the fewest number of elements in it. So we might ask the question, is D a subset of, say, C? And the answer is yes, D is a subset of C, because every element in D, that means 1 and 3, are also included in C. You could ask the reverse question, is C a subset of D? And the answer is no, because not every element in C is also in D. More specifically, C has this element 2 that does not appear in set D. So the notation we use here is we just put a line or a slash through that subset symbol. So that says that C is not a subset of D. We could also point out that D is a subset of E for the same reason. D includes 1 and 3, and those two elements are also in E. We could also ask the question, is C a subset of E? So you look at the set C that has 1, 2, and 3 in it, and you ask the question, are all of those elements also in E? And the answer is yes. So C is a subset of E. In fact, C equals E because C and E have all of the same elements. So I guess that means that a set is a subset of itself. That sounds like a strange philosophical statement, but it is true. Let me just give you a couple more examples. Is the set that includes shoes, pants, and shorts a subset of the set that includes skirts, shorts, and shirts? So the question is every element of this set also included in this set? The answer is no, because this set has the element pants, which is not included in this set. So to make this a true statement, we're gonna put a line through here, and maybe one more example. I wonder if this is a true statement. We introduced this symbol in the last video. This is the null set. And the question is the null set a subset of the set containing 1, 5, and 7? And well, the null set doesn't contain anything. So we can still say that every element of the null set is also an element of this set here. So this is actually a true statement. In fact, the null set is a subset of every set. So as you may be realizing, sets and subsets get real weird real fast. Let me make a little bit of space so we can define a proper subset. Let's bring back our original two sets, A and B. If we put this symbol in between the two of them without the little equal sign, that says that A is a proper subset of B. And the definition of a proper subset starts off the same as the definition of a subset. But for A to be a proper subset of B, A cannot equal B. So if we still use those same sets from above, the set D is a proper subset of C. It is still the case that every element in D is included in C. And it is true that the set D is not equal to the set C. D is also still a proper subset of E for the same reasons. However, if we look at the sets C and E, C is not a proper subset of E because C and E are equal to each other. They're the same thing. So what that means is a set is not a proper subset of itself. To get a little bit more practice with sets, let's do the following example. Let's list all of the subsets of A, which is the set containing 1 and 2. Well, let's do it. So this set here, 1, 2, is a subset of A. Another example of a subset of A would be the set just containing 1. Another would be a set just containing the number 2. And there's one more, though it's kind of tricky. A minute ago, I said that the null set is a subset of every set. So one more subset of A is the null set. Let's do the same thing with this set. All right, I think this list is going to be longer because we have three elements in this set. So let's start listing all of its subsets. There is a subset of B. How about the set containing just 1 and 2? That is also a subset of B. The set containing 1 and 3. The set containing 2 and 3. The set containing just 1 is a subset of B. The set containing just 2. The set containing just 3. And there's one more. It's the tricky one. It is the null set is a subset of B. So up here, we had a set that had two elements in it, and we discovered that that set had four subsets. Then we looked at a set that had three elements in it, and we discovered that this set has eight subsets. Now, I guess you can just trust me on this, or you can write it out yourself, but if we looked at a set that had four elements in it, we would find that that set had 16 subsets. So every time we add an element to a set, our number of subsets doubles. I bet you didn't see this coming, but there is a formula for the number of subsets that a set has. There it is. The number of distinct subsets of a set A is 2 to the n, where n is the number of elements in A. So if our set has 3 elements, as this one does right here, we should expect that set to have 2 to the third power subsets. That's 2 cubed. That does equal 8, and that's what we found in this example up here. Not to get too detailed, but we could also ask the question, how many proper subsets does A and B have? Well, the only difference between a subset and a proper subset is that a proper subset can't equal the original set. So if we look at our list of subsets of A, the only one that isn't a proper subset is this one right here. So A has 3 proper subsets. We can make the same argument down here. If we're wondering how many proper subsets B has, we can look at our big list of subsets of B, and the only one that isn't a proper subset is, again, this one right here. So we'll take that off the list, and we'll say that B has 7 proper subsets. So one more formula for you. The number of distinct proper subsets of A is 2 to the n, but we're going to subtract 1. All right, there are many examples and homework problems and little tricky notation details that we need to talk about, but let's stop this video here, and hopefully that'll get you started on the homework. And I look forward to seeing you in the next one.